ambassador to England or France. You may like to gamble, you might like to dance. You may be the heavyweight champion of the world. You may be a socialite with a long string of pearls, but you're gonna have to serve somebody. Yes, indeed, you're gonna have to serve somebody. Well, it may be the devil or it may be the Lord, but you're gonna have to serve somebody.
Thank you for joining us today on Something to Think About with Pastor Mike, where the topics can range from current events, historical perspectives, practical Bible application, to whatever's on his mind today. People have stereotypes of what it means to be a Christian, and one thing's for sure, Pastor Mike loves breaking those stereotypes. Pastor Mike Hasseltine is the senior pastor of Maranatha Church with campuses in Forest Lake and Chisago, Minnesota. With over 40 years of practical pastoral ministry, Pastor Mike challenges us to be real people, loving a real God, right in the midst of all our real lives. Now, here's Pastor Mike.
Hey, good morning to our listeners out there. It is a beautiful day. Wait a minute, almost every day is a beautiful day. And thanks for joining us. Hey, gentlemen, producers over there, Mike, Jay, how you doing?
Good, we good.
You're good, huh?
Hola.
Hola. ¿Cómo está? That's good.
Muy bien.
Oh, it's good. And then, yes, Jenny's going to go ahead and up and play some pickleball. Hey, Jenny, don't get hurt. Don't get hurt. Hey, we have just a really special guest that I'll be introducing in just a moment. But I want to just remind you that you can go to our website, yourliferadio.com, and listen on your computer. And you can send us any questions or comments at wajc@yourliferadio.com. Let me just tell you a couple things that are happening at Maranatha. Man, today we had a blood drive going from 9 till 2 o'clock, and there still are spots available. You can go to redcross.org, redcross.org, and get on some of those dates that are left today, 9 to 2, a blood drive here at Maranatha. And then two big events coming up. June 2nd, that's almost upon us. We are having a blessing of the bikes. It's Sunday. Church service is at 10:30. And following that, right after that, is the blessing of the bikes. That's going to begin at around 12:30. There's food. There's vendors. Vendors are open at 9 a.m. It's a big deal. Last year, we had 1,000 motorcycles out in our parking lot, driving through the lobby of the church. And then another huge event is our car show. Holy smoke. Car show, Saturday, August 10th. And for, again, for more details, you can go to our website at the church, realchurch.org. Okay, so today we have a special guest joining us in the studio, and that is Sheriff Brandon Thien. Welcome.
Thanks, Pastor Mike. Thanks for having me here today.
It's great to have you here. You know, people can't see us because it's radio, but you and I have a couple really good-looking haircuts.
Yes, very very aerodynamic.
Yes, we are. We're like brothers from another mother. They say they don't put marble on cheap furniture. Only the expensive stuff. Like you and I.
Yes.
Yeah. Oh, that is just so wild. Okay, so we are going to really... What prompted me to give you a call and invite you in was this idea of frauds and all the stuff that's taking place. But before we get there, let's just really back up the train. Let's get to know Sheriff Thien. So where'd you grow up? Tell me a little bit about your background.
So I grew up in the suburb of New Brighton, grew up there and lived there until I moved into Chisago County in the beginning of 1999.
1999. So, were you already in your law enforcement career?
I was. When I moved up to Chisago County, I had already been working for the Rush City Police Department for just over a year, and then had decided that I'd be locating to Chisago County. My wife and I had decided that and had bought a house up in the city of North Branch and then eventually moved up into the county.
So you've been in law enforcement how many years already?
27 years in Chisago County. And then 25 years with the Chisago County Sheriff's Office.
Oh my gosh. Man, you've been doing this for a few days. Yes. You know, and actually though, but you did it back when it was maybe a little bit more fun, a little bit more enjoyable. Hey, just make a comment, you know, and I know that you're going to obviously try to be politically correct a little bit, but tell us, how has police work, law enforcement changed since, you know, the events of George Floyd? And other events going on in our country everywhere.
Yeah, so there's been a lot of change with technology that has changed the job. There's been a lot of change in different state statutes, licensure for peace officers in the state of Minnesota, the amount of training, different things like that. So definitely we did have, with the George Floyd incident, we did start to see some different type of police reform where the public had called out for various different types of trainings, different things like that. You know, but technology has definitely changed how we do the job. You know, example of that would be drones. Drones have significantly changed law enforcement in the last 8 to 10 years in our availability to use drones, giving us a different perspective on different types of incidents. There's robots. There's just different things like that. Where back when I first started in law enforcement, we would have been expecting police officers, deputies to approach more dangerous situations out in the open without those types of tools.
So these drones, obviously safety for the officers, that's helped provide a lot more safety?
They have. So an example might be is if we are have an incident occurring inside of a business or a residence that is serious. Back in the day, without drones and so forth, we might have approached that house out in the open without cover, maybe have knocked down a door and maybe sent in a dog or went in directly with officers or deputies. And nowadays, what we would do is we would approach that residence or business with an armored vehicle. We wouldn't be getting out of that protection, and we would utilize equipment such as like an articulating ram to knock in a window or a front door, and then we would launch a drone from you know, that secure cover.
This is sounding high tech.
And then send the drone into that residence or business to see what type of situation we might be walking into. Are there ambushes? How many people might be inside? Different things like that. And so then we have better knowledge of exactly what we're dealing with. We might some of Chisago County is definitely more rural, so we might have situations where we're looking for someone in a wooded area or someone's property might be larger. So before we might do something, we might put up a drone to be able to look at that property or see different things like that. So that technology has definitely made things safer for us over the years.
I don't think your average person is aware of, because you see these, you know, little snippets on TV, and an officer goes in a room and then, you know, somebody tragically gets shot. I don't think people ever think about the safety of the officer. If you got to remember, he doesn't know what's in there. It's a crapshoot. You're going in a place where you do not know. But if somebody's laying in ambush, that's you're toast. I mean, it's just really bad. So I read a statistic the other day that on the average, one police officer is shot every day in the United States. What in the world is wrong with this picture?
Yeah, I mean, I can tell you, you know, first, your comment about those situations. I mean, typically, like our domestic family type situations are very dangerous. We've seen that as of recent with situations right here in Minnesota where officers have been unfortunately killed responding to domestics. Those types of situations are very volatile. There's a lot of emotion. They change quickly. To your comment about peace officers being shot, I can tell you in the state of Minnesota, I can't remember the very specific statistic, but in the state of Minnesota, let's say in the last 12 months, we've had more police officers, law enforcement officers in the state of Minnesota shot than anyone can remember. I remember a statistic of maybe it was 28. Not obviously a lot of them were injured. Not all of them were killed. But the amount of incidents that law enforcement are taking fire across the country is getting out of control.
Yeah, again, I don't want to pontificate on this too much, but at the same time, like in Minneapolis on the news, you saw these police officers going in. It was a suicide type threat and case. I thought they were going to send in social workers to deal with these situations. But here we are. Who's going in there? Police officers. Anyway, you don't got to make a comment on that. Oh, wow. Okay, so what in the world brought you into, or how did you go down the choice path of law enforcement?
Well, one of my neighbors was a St. Paul police officer, a canine handler, and his daughter was the same age as me, so we were really good friends and spent a lot of time with that family and got introduced to law enforcement kind of through that. Then when I went to school, I originally wasn't going into law enforcement, but had some friends and had some thoughts of going into it. That field definitely intrigued me, and eventually decided that that would be the field that I wanted to go into. It's an exciting job. It's every day is different. You're not necessarily stuck at a desk every day, and you're able to be out in the community and do some great
things. You especially,
things
and, just to let me interrupt you, you are not one of these sheriffs that is stuck in the office, because I see you out and about at so many community events in the city, and this is just Wyoming that I see you in. But I know you're involved in Chisago and Lindstrom and on down the road. So, but yeah, you are a PR guy. You're out there. It's really cool to see you.
Yeah, so our sheriff's office actually has one of the biggest following on social media, and we have a social media team, and we've made that a priority to be transparent with the community. And
it's because you're funny, too.
So
your department, you put some funny stuff out there.
Yeah, we definitely try to make light of some of those things that we can and add a little bit of humor to connect with the public. And we are trying to, let the public know about our agency, the things that we deal with. Actually, law enforcement is probably one of the least understood professions until you actually take part in it. And so we do a lot of things, whether it's social media, connecting with the public, putting on Citizens Academy. We do our best to, try to educate the public on what we do as a profession and so forth like that. And yeah, as the Chisago County Sheriff, I try to be the people sheriff. So that's why I am so connected with the community at all those different types of events. The position of sheriff is elected, and it's important to have the pulse of the public, because I'm making decisions for this community, dealing with public safety and knowing what their concerns and the types of situations that they're dealing with is important for me to know.
No, as a county sheriff, you are elected. You made mention of that, and I didn't really understand this. I'm sure a lot of listeners don't understand either the difference between the county and the local police department. The local police department, they're hired by the city council, and then the sheriff, you're elected. So just give a brief overview of what's the difference between a sheriff's department and a police department?
Well, so starting just with the difference in the leaders, your police chief is hired by the city council, has a contract, you know, with the city to be that police chief, and they're not elected. So they're appointed by that city council. So a police department is specifically responsible for responding to incidents, crime, providing assistance within their legal jurisdiction of the city. Typically, a police department, you know, has a patrol division. You know, so they have their patrol cars out, they have investigators, they have administration, and they're dealing with crime specifically within that city and dealing with enforcing, like, the city's ordinances. You know, the big difference with the sheriff's office is I am elected. Every sheriff in the state of Minnesota serves a four-year term. And I have a county board. But the county board provides me with a budget, but they don't really have any jurisdiction or overseeing what happens, you know, as far as the type of law enforcement we provide and so forth like that. So when it comes to political type of situations, you know, being an elected leader allows me some more of the freedoms to provide what the, you know, what the people want. And then the big difference with the sheriff's office is as a sheriff, I have statutory responsibilities to provide certain things. I'm responsible for the county jail, so I oversee the county jail. We also have, similar to the police departments, we have a patrol division. So we've got, you know, we're patrolling all of Chisago County. We also provide specific services to six cities within the county. They contract with the sheriff's office to provide their specific law enforcement. And then sheriffs are responsible for providing law enforcement services to the unincorporated areas of counties. And so we also have the jail in Chisago County, and in most counties, the sheriff's office is also responsible for 911 communications. So,
wow.
Yeah, so in the sheriff's office, we have...
man.
You know, I have 911 dispatchers and a 911 center, and those dispatchers actually dispatch to our three local police departments in Chisago County, which are the City of North Branch, Wyoming, and then Lakes Area Police Department that oversee the cities of Lindstrom and Chisago City. And then statutorily, sheriffs are also responsible for providing court security and dealing with all the court orders coming out. So we deal with civil process, all the civil process, regardless of where it is in the county, warrants. We do a lot of things administratively as well. Sheriffs are responsible for your firearms carry permits. So anyone in the state of Minnesota that's looking for a firearms personal carry permit would come see their local sheriff. And then, you know, they would see their police department if they live in a jurisdiction with the police department to get their permit to purchase. Otherwise, I do that for most of the citizens within the county as well. So we do a lot of different things. I also have emergency management for the county underneath the sheriff's office. So we have a lot of different divisions, not just dealing with responding to crime, investigating the crime. Sheriffs have a lot of statutory responsibilities besides that normal things that a police department might deal with.
I have just had my whole understanding expanded. I had no idea, literally, of what the difference was and what a sheriff's department, a county does. That's huge. That is remarkable. I want to shift gears a little bit again, and that is, you've been in this for a while, and I know it's going to sound like you're patting your own back, but man, share with us some of the things that you have been involved in, some of the things, boards that you sit on. Tell us a little bit about that overview.
Yeah, so, you know, some of my initiatives as a sheriff deal with school safety, childhood development, traffic safety, enforcement and education, drug awareness and prevention, mental health issues. And then what we kind of talked about a little bit was the senior awareness to fraud and scams. But so some of the community involvement that I do is I'm a member of the Lake Center for Youth and Families, which is located in Forest Lake, real close to here. But they serve all of Chisago County's youth as well as Northern Washington County and Indianoka County, a great organization that provides youth with different types of counseling and intervention and different things like that. I'm also also on the Lakes Region EMS Board of Directors. And Lakes Region EMS is a local ambulance nonprofit that provides Chisago County most of their ambulance service. I'm also involved with Chisago Lakes Beyond Yellow Ribbon, which serves our local veterans in the area and so forth like that. I'm a advisory board member on North Star for the North Star Advocacy Center in Bram, which deal with youth who have been victims of sexual assault, and they help families with resources and the investigation. And I'm also a board member for the East Central Violent Offenders and Drug Task Force. So in Chisago County, we participate with Isani County, Kanabec County, and Pine County to create a task force, and their major goal is to fight larger amounts, quantities of drugs coming into this region. And so each one of those sheriff's office provides a full-time investigator to participate in that task force. I'm a board member with that. And then right here in Chisago County, I'm the president of the Chisago County Chiefs Association. And so the local chiefs and us, we meet regularly to talk about issues right here in Chisago County. And we have a great working relationship with those police departments and how we can work together. And then I talked a little bit about the childhood stuff. I participate and support the Chisago County ACEs program, which is Adverse Child Experiences. Recently, Chisago County created a Opioid Action Council. I'm a member of that, and that council is looking at how to best utilize the funds that every county in the state of Minnesota received from the opioid settlement. So all these counties are getting money given back to them from those settlements, and our council is formed on how we're going to best utilize those to fight the opioid pandemic that we're seeing here. I'm a DNR youth firearms instructor.
Do you ever have time to be married and have kids?
It stays busy, and I'm lucky enough to have the support that I do for my wife and kids.
Kidding.
There's a lot of stuff.
You know, people, again, just expanding our minds. People think that cops basically just drive around and give people speeding tickets, harass them for, annoying little things. And you're actually very, very busy.
Yeah, so a lot of those things that I'm involved in, obviously are helping support those initiatives that I want to have right here in Chisago County. And, a lot of sheriffs like myself are very active in their communities, and all the deputies, all of my jailers, 911 dispatchers, the workers, most of them live right here in Chisago County. If they're not specifically in the county, they're pretty close. And we're members of this community. We're going to the same churches. We're going to the same grocery stores. We're youth athletic coaches. So it's our community as well. And sometimes the public doesn't realize that when we're off duty, we're just not wearing our uniforms, and we're amongst all these people, and we're doing what we can to make our community as best we can, like a lot of other people.
You really are a part of it and involved. I love having a representation from your department at our car show and our bike blessing. It's just good to see them. It's not like you're the enemy, it's us against them. I love to see that and help to portray for other people to realize that law enforcement people are just people. They're people and joining us. Okay, so when we come back, we're going to really now dive into this idea of frauds and scams and having people take advantage of us. So we will return in about 30 seconds.
You're listening to Something to Think About with me, Pastor Mike, a production of WAJC, Your Life Radio on 88.1 and 91.7 FM. We'd love to hear from you. If you have questions or comments about today's show, email us at waj@yourliferadio.com. If you're ever in the Forest Lake area, I'd love to personally invite you to join us for a Sunday morning service at 9:30 a.m. or Wednesday evenings at 6:30 p.m. There's something for everyone.
Something to Think About with Pastor Mike is a production of WAJC Your Life Radio, which is owned and operated by Maranatha Assembly of God in Forest Lake, Minnesota. You can find more information on the web at realchurch.org. Now, back to something to think about.
Okay, so we're back to something to think about, and today we're having a little bit of understanding and explanation of what it's like to be a sheriff in a county department. So we have, as a special guest with us this morning, Sheriff Brandon Thien. He is the sheriff for Chisago County, of which our church is in. And it's just great to see you guys always involved and around. And okay, so now for the rest of the program, let's get into, I know it's catching a lot of national news, seeing commercials and stuff, but specifically, I've heard that this area seems to be an uptick on people trying to do scams and take advantage of people. So, man, take us away. Let us have it. Fill us in on maybe what's happening, or obviously into what to be looking for, how people can protect themselves, who is it mainly targeting, all of that. That's all you got to do, just all of that.
Well, thanks, Pastor Mike. So frauds and scams, it's not a new problem, but we're not seeing it's going to be leaving anytime soon just because of the sheer amount of money that is involved. It seems like it's a daily occurrence, whether I'm in my office or out in the community, that I'm either talking to someone or I'm hearing our deputies or a local police department here locally responding to an incident where unfortunately someone fell victim, to a fraud or scam.
That to me amazes me, even just that comment, that daily you hear it, you run into it. I've always just imagined this is one of those one-off, kind of a weird deal. Somebody gets caught up in something. But the way you put it like that, yeah, these thieves have, that's their job. They get up every day and all they have to do is just keep hammering and going after it. But the prevalency, every day you hear something like that.
Yeah, and it's, unfortunately it's really tragic for our victims because it's very hard for law enforcement a lot of times to recover funds that have been lost, to be able to prosecute the people that are doing it. And we're talking about some significant amounts of money. Not that long ago we had a resident that lost $100,000. And it's not uncommon. Whoa. Yeah, it's not uncommon for people to lose, $2,000, $3,000, $5,000, $10,000, $15,000, $20,000 to various types of scams that are occurring, and so it can be it can be life changing for someone to fall victim to this, and one of the reasons why I talked a little bit about my initiatives and I do speak a lot in the community at various types of organizations, different things like that, because power is knowledge, and. The thing is that people need to protect themselves. It's if they put up a little bit of resistance. One of the analogies that I use is, we have a lot of situations, especially now that it's getting warmer out, where thieves will run through a neighborhood and they'll pull on every car handle that they can come across. And if they find a car door that is open, what do? They ransack the car. They're going to take the change out of the cup holder. They're going to take anything in that vehicle that might be of value. And then they move on and they move quick. And the next car they get to, if that car door is locked, typically what happens is they move on.
They move on.
Yeah, they don't want to make noise. They don't want to cause attention to themselves. They're not going to break that window. Maybe they will if they see something very valuable, but typically they move on. So that's kind of like this. If people would lock their doors, just pay attention a little bit, have a little bit of knowledge, put up a little bit of resistance, meaning lock their car door, mm-hmm. when they have conversations with these people that are trying to scam them, typically those people move on because they are fast paced. They want to make their money. And so when I speak to a large group of people, let's say we have 100 people in a room I'm speaking to, I explain to them that if 99 people in that room don't fall for that scam, but one does, then those people have made their money for the day and they're happy. And we want, the people to be the people that, put up a little bit of resistance and don't become a victim.
Yeah, nobody wants to be a victim of this, and everybody thinks I won't be duped. So getting educated, I think, is pretty important. Because I know that like my mom, she gets calls fairly regularly claiming to be my son. They'll use his name. Hey, Grandma, this is, you know, hey, I found myself in a need. I need some money. And I always told my mom, our son will never ask you for money. That's one thing he's not going to need. He's not going to ask you for money. It ain't going to happen. Mom, just hang up.
Yeah, so the you know, one of the older scams that's still being used and still successful is, you know, specifically what you just stated is, you know, we call it the grandparent scams, where they, you know, they'll put a child on the phone and say, Grandma, you know, scenarios that they might use is that, you know, a grandchild's been involved in a car accident and they need money before they can get medical help. Another one is that they've actually been arrested and they need bail money. So they'll put someone on the phone, you know, that sounds like a kid. They might even know your grandchild's his or her name from social media.
Which they did,
like,
yeah.
And then, you know, so they, you know, they, there's some things that are pretty common, you know, with scams, and, you know, and they try to have that personal connection, whether it's from a family member or it's from an organization that you're familiar with, to kind of break that, you know, break that ice, and that gets you past that first initial shock of what's, you know, being talked about, and then they go from there.
Okay, so let's back up just a little bit. The idea that we live in Minnesota nice. We don't like to put up any opposition. We want to be friendly. We want to be accommodating. If somebody asks us a question, we almost feel compelled that we have to answer that question. Hey, what's your Social Security number? And we just kind of, we think that everybody knows not to do that. But this Minnesota nice, man, we kind of just play into it, whatever anybody on the other line asks us. So how can we arm ourselves, like you said, educate ourselves? Knowledge is power. What are some things that listeners can do for a first, like, test or a bit of resistance?
Sure. So, you know, one thing, one of the things I always say is, if it's too good to be true, beware. So that falls into a lot of different situations, whether it's free vacations, publisher's clearinghouse, different things like that. You know, we always want, you know, that the easy money or that easy prize. But in reality these days, is that something that's really going to happen? So whenever we see something like that, that's, you know, that kind of fits that bill, we definitely, you know, have to beware. The other thing is I talk a lot about taking and controlling your communication. And just for an example of that, and we can talk about that, whether it's, let's say, utility bill. A lot of people in this area use Excel.
Okay.
So for an example for that, let's say you get contacted, and like I said, they try to portray themselves from an organization that you know. Excel is a common name. We use them. So they obviously utilize some of those companies that we're familiar with. So an example would be, you get a phone call. I'm a representative from Excel with technology. They can even make the number that pops up on your caller ID say that it's from Excel.
Wow.
When it's not. And then they say, you know what, there's a problem with your account. And they might say something like, well, we haven't been receiving your payments for your bills. And initially you're like, well, I've been paying my bills. I've been sending my checks. And they're like, well, there's a problem with your account. Let's see if we can take care of this. And maybe they even know your name, your address, from your account, because of some identity sharing, or we hear about these companies that get hacked and personal information is shared. Another thing is it's not uncommon for law enforcement to stop cars, and in the back seat of those cars are local mail. People steal mail.
People steal mail.
Yeah, so that's another.
Wow.
That's another way that people their information, being their names, addresses, things like that, can be found. So back to that story, they say there's a problem with your account, and then they say, well, we can take care of that, and then they might simply say, well, let's log into your account. Or they might even say, well, I need to confirm your identity before I can go into your account. So, you know, your name's this and this. You live at this address. And heck, they might even know your last four digits, your Social Security number. But they might say, you know, to confirm that, can you give me your Social Security number? Hmm. And then the second that you give them your Social Security number, they now have enough information to open up a bank account, get credit cards, do a lot of things, wow, steal your identity. So a two-minute phone call about some simple questions where they try to trick you can cause a lot of problems. So like I said, we need to take control of that communication. So instead of being that Minnesota nice you mentioned, you need to ask some questions. Okay, if there's a problem with my account, how about, can I talk to your supervisor? Or how about you say, you know what, I'm busy right now, I'm gonna have to call you back, can I get a callback number? And then what you're able to do is you're able to maybe go to your invoice or go online on a secure site and find the correct number for customer service. And then you contact them back and contact Excel and say, you know what, I was called by you and I'm wondering if there's a problem with my account. And a lot of times these companies, now this could be a bank, a credit card, your health insurance, those same types of situations that I just described could occur with any of those, right?
Yep, I can see that.
So these companies know that their names are being used to scam people. So they don't mind if you stop that communication and say, you know what, I think I'm going to call you back at a later time. They're going to be fine with that. So once again, that little bit of resistance, kind of like locking your car door.
Yep. Just a question.
Yep. So sometimes in those situations, you'll just get hung up on right then and there. Well, then you know
then
that.
Then you know, yeah, yep. It's obvious.
And if it's someone from Excel, they're going to understand why you're taking that, and they're going to, they'll be happy to have you make that phone call.
So
on the back
on the other line, if you send somebody being urgent, somebody kind of being irritated and pressing, that's probably a good clue that this is somebody that's trying to scam you.
Yeah, correct. And like I said, we're taking control of... actually, it's a great point you made there, because there's four real big signs, telling points that you're dealing with someone with a scam. And the first one is, as I've already talked about, they pretend to be from an organization or something that you're familiar with.
That you're familiar with. Yep. You're comfortable. It's part of your life.
And then there's a problem or a prize. Okay, so you've either won money.
A problem or a prize.
Yeah. So, you know, there's a problem with your account, or you've been selected for a free trip, something like that. So they say there's a problem or a prize. And then what you just mentioned, they try to pressure you to act immediately. They don't want you to take time to find that correct number for the callback. They don't want you to think about what they're trying to propose to you. They want you to act very quickly so that... The grandparent scam is a perfect example of that. They say there's a problem with the grandson, granddaughter. If you don't act immediately, there's going to be a problem. They're not going to get released from jail. They're not going to get medical treatment.
Yep.
With that immediacy, they're not contacting family to see if, you know, their grandson...
Is it true?
Yeah. Is their grandson actually traveling or, you know stuff like that. And then another big one is they ask you to pay in a specific way. Now, years ago, they used to have people wire money, and then as of late, it's more about gift cards. And people don't realize with a gift card, if you purchase a gift card, it's not like you need to physically hand someone a gift card. You can talk to them on the phone, give them the numbers on that gift card and the security code on the back. And as soon as they have that money is removed from that card immediately. So that's
one,
wow, that's one way. And then one that we're starting to see now is the request of cryptocurrency. So in order to make payment for something like that, they might have you go to a certain site and purchase cryptocurrency, and then they'll get your login information, then they'll take your cryptocurrency, you know, from you. So those are, you know, four big signs, you know, that's a scam. And a lot of times when they have you kind of going down that road, they kind of continue to force you, to...
And they're very believable. Obviously, these guys are salesmen. They get people not because they're stupid, because they're smart and they know how to interact with the human nature, try to building a relationship, trying to build this friendliness. So when you put up any kind of resistance at all, it's probably a good way to find out how they act, if they get irritated, stuff like that, like you had mentioned.
Yeah, correct. And they are very good salesmen. You know, the one example I explained where we had a resident lose a very large sum of money, you know, Publishers Clearing House, they believed that they had won the prize. And once the person had known that they kind of had them on the line, they then added to it that they had won a car. And you know, so before you can get your prize, you know, they wanted you to, you have to pay the taxes on it.
Pay the taxes, yeah.
So once again, that's another thing that you would never want to do is make any type of payment for a promise or a prize without receiving it. You know, so in this situation, they had to pay the tax on the prize, and then they had to pay the tax on the vehicle. And then in order to get the vehicle to here to Minnesota, they had to pay the freight.
Freight shipping.
So, exactly. So all those costs just continually started to add up, you know.
And you just get sucked in that tornado. I mean, you just get sucked in it, and because it's, you believe it. Oh, man, they're asking for this. Man, you've won this. Yeah, it's all I need is this. You got to send me this. And, like, yeah, it's scary, especially for our elderly. Not that anybody can't be duped and sucked in, but do you have any other, like, special warnings or things that the elderly, because they don't want problems. So if it's Excel calling or their credit card call and there's a problem, they just want to fix. They just want to fix. Would the advice almost always be, say, I will call the company later, hang up and call? What is there anything specifically you could help with, you know, our seniors?
Yeah, like I said, you definitely want to you put up that resistance, ask some questions. Actually, for our senior population, one of the things I talk about with phones is, do they even have to answer them? You know, so
they'll leave a message.
Exactly.
Most people today, yeah.
Yeah. So, and with technology the way it is, you can't trust caller ID. It's real easy to get a voicemail message. Actually, most of it's transcribed right for you. So a lot of times I tell people is make sure that your family and friends and the people that you get calls from a lot, make sure to put their contacts in those phones. And for those seniors that might not be that tech savvy, I can guarantee you they have family members,
grandkids. Yeah. Just grab your nearest granddaughter or son.
Yeah, they'll definitely be able to help them out, get those contacts in. And then, you know, if they're, do they have to answer those phones? Now, they could be having some medical appointments, different things like that that they're expecting, and maybe caller ID would help them with those calls. But a lot of these calls that are coming in are from random numbers from maybe overseas or other parts of the country, different things like that. You know, why even answer those calls? Because it's the Minnesota Nice thing.
We feel obligated.
Yeah. When we don't need to. In those situations, don't answer the phone. They'll leave a voicemail if it's that important. You'll be able to then you can listen to that voicemail or see the transcription of that information. And then, once again, you're taking control of that communication. You don't have to act on it. Or if you do, and it's a scam, fraud from Amazon or your health insurance or XL Energy or banking, anything like that, then you can then go in a secure way, log into your account or drive to your local bank.
Even as you were just describing all the different things, there is a myriad of relationships in our life that we would have a very trusting reason to do business, a reason to listen. It's amazing. So I have taken that bit of advice. I'm not sure. Partly it's because I'm so busy, I don't want to take every phone call, but I've learned it is a great screening process. When somebody calls, if it's not already in my contact, I will wait for them to leave a message. Because if it's important, they're going to leave me a message.
Yeah, and in reality, I mean, you can get that message, you know, within 30 seconds. You know exactly what it's about. And if it's that important that you you definitely need to return the call, you're able to do so. You know, some of the other things, like I talked about the mail. You know, if you have outgoing mail, if you throw that mail in the mailbox and put that flag up that, you know, that's a sign that, you know, checks might be in that mail, different things like that. So a lot of your identity can be taken that way. So, you know, I always recommend that people, you know, put outgoing mail, drop it off at the post office. The other thing
ruining my day, you know. Yeah. You know, I like to the old fashioned. We live in Mayberry, and everybody's nice. You know, you put your mail in the mailbox, put the flag up. That's kind of who I am. But I gotta be more careful of that, huh?
Yeah, I mean, the post office service. I mean, they actually have an application that you can put on your phone that you can sign up for, and all mail is scanned. So when mail is before you even get it, you could have an app to see what mail you should have in your mailbox on that day. And that way, if you're missing mail, you can make those comparisons. You know, the other thing, technology is can be used, you know, to help you, but then, you know, it can be used against you as well. So an example that we see scams on Facebook, you know, most people are on Facebook, and I think everyone realizes how easy accounts can get hacked these days, where, you know, you get messages or, you know, posts from people on Facebook, and, you know, and they're like, oh, my account got hacked and stuff like that. So one of the things that we see is an account gets hacked, and then they'll put up a post of their, you know, they're going to move, or they're selling a bunch of items with pictures, and then friends, family think, oh, they're selling these items, and then they reach out to them on Messenger, like, hey, I would be interested, for an example, let's just say a riding lawnmower, and they're like, well, usually in that message it's like, you know, I'm not going to hold any items without down payment. So then people make contact with them, and their account's been stolen. They're not even talking to their friend or the person they think they're talking to, and they're making financial transactions on property that's not even true. It's not theirs.
And, oh, my gosh.
And people are putting down payments on that property. And so they're gathering money until the word can get out that their account was hacked. But a lot of times they've already gathered, you know, some various funds up, things like that.
Oh, that is... Yeah, it's kind of frightening. I think about, again, our elderly especially, that are just a little bit more prone to be vulnerable. It's scary, this day and age in which we live. So are there some places where people could go? Is there like an online site? Are there things that places or resources that they could avail themselves through the county's office, through the local police department, through anything?
You know, so locally here for the sheriff's office and the police departments, you know, we don't need to be contacted if you're not a victim of a scam. There's so many scams that are happening. You know, you can report scams to business bureaus, things like that on the on the federal level. You can go to reportfraud.ftc.gov, and there you can put in different scams, whether you're a victim or not, and they'll collect that information, and then that gets reshared out to law enforcement in various agencies of kind of what's happening. That's kind of the gathering place for that. You can sign up for email updates on current trends, different things like that. You can go to ftc.gov/scams, and that's another location that you know, you can be notified of kind of what's happening, kind of stay in the know. Another one that you can do is if you think your identity's been stolen or anything like that, you can go to identitytheft.gov, and they have a lot of tips on how to deal with you know, situations if indeed your identity's been taken from you and so forth like that.
Hey, you know, we're going to keep some of this stuff on hand at the station, and if people have want more information, they just call the church phone number, and that is 651-464-3131. Tell you what, our time is done today, but Sheriff, I want to thank you for your time. It's just great to have you come in.
Yeah, thanks, Pastor Mike, for having me.
It's fantastic. I look forward to seeing you all around town, bebopping around, involved in this, that, and the other thing, because you are definitely involved.
So,
fantastic. I wish everybody could see his bright, smiley face. He is a great guy. Have a great day yourself.
Hey, thanks for tuning in today. Please join us right here each Friday morning at 8 a.m. If you have any questions or comments about today's show, email wajc@yourliferadio.com. You can hear more from Pastor Mike at Maranatha's website, realchurch.org, on the Messages and Media tab. The opinions expressed here are not necessarily those of the owner.
You may be an ambassador to England or France. You may like to gamble. You might like to dance. You may be the heavyweight champion of the world. You may be a socialite with a long string of pearls, but you're gonna have to serve somebody. Yes, indeed, you're gonna have to serve somebody. Well, it may be the devil or it may be the Lord, but you're gonna have to serve somebody.